Thank you for joining Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we will take you inside the auto industry like never before. And when I say we, I mean me and my very, very knowledgeable and illustrious panel of journalists located in the film strip below. And as always, we'll have them introduce themselves, talk a little bit about who they are, where they are, and then we will get into the news. There's a lot to talk about this week that happened in the auto industry. And we'll get right into that after they introduce themselves. We'll start with Frank.
Oh.
Yay! I was hoping you'd do that.
Well, wake up.
Since you put it like that, it's Frank Washington. Excuse me. I'm based here in Detroit. I do a automotive column as well as a website. Both of them are entitled AboutThatCar.com. I'm working on a book about blacks in the auto industry, and right now we're just enjoying the weather. It may be 40 degrees, but that's about 40 more than it was 2 weeks ago.
Great, Greg.
Hi, I'm Greg Morris, and I'm executive producer for Bumper to Bumper TV. I'm based in Atlanta, and currently I'm in my basement office. I got Dick Cheney behind the wall here. For the record, it is 51 degrees and raining and misty here today. We do a weekly video report on new car developments and products. And looking forward to having a great discussion. Also looking forward to the Atlanta Auto Show next week and the New York Auto Show the week after that.
Well, two auto shows in a row. Linda.
Hi, I'm Linda Sharp, and I'm coming to you from sort of a drizzly overcast Blue Ridge Mountains within a stone's throw of Mayberry, USA. Been in this business for 20-something years. I've had a syndicated newspaper column on the Cox Wire and the New York Times Wire service that was based out of the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. Today I produce a website. It's called sharpdriver.com. It's my miscellaneous ramblings about things automotive, be they racing, motorsports, SECA, NASCAR, and a blog on new car reviews and products and things that are timely. I invite you to check it out. And know most all of these people for many, many years, and I'm proud to be their colleague. And I, as Greg would say, I think we'll have some fun today. So welcome.
Valerie, introduce yourself.
Hi, everyone. I'm so glad to be back. This is Valerie Menard, based in Austin, Texas. Yes, we're South by Southwest is currently devouring our city. I'm safely in my home, however. I have been an automotive journalist for about 16 years, and I just launched a brand new venture called Latino Traffic Report, which would be my new website. This is my first solo project. So I'm happy to be here and happy to join everyone and talking about cars.
Well, we'll make that the first in the news topic. Tell us a little bit more about your project.
Well, you know, it's my own. It's a website / blog. This would be, and I'll be talking all about cars. This will be a place for my car reviews, also launches, just all the information that we normally put about the auto industry. But then there will also, of course, be the Latino angle, which would be, industry events. I just posted something from Toyota. They just did a celebration about being, you know, the number one brand for the Hispanic market for the last 10 years. They had a big concert. So things like that that make it more relevant to the Latino car consumer.
Now, is this in English or Spanish or both?
In English.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I think that event from Toyota was in Miami this week.
I think it was in California.
Was
it? With Ricky Martin?
No, they were in Miami doing something with an Hispanic festival of some sort.
Hispanicize.
Yes.
Yeah, that was in Miami. I'd love to go to that. So, as always, my history in the Latino market and as a multi-generational Latino has been this market, the born and raised here, so English is our first language, and so we do look for information in English, and so I'm just continuing with what my expertise has always been and my passion.
Oh, okay. Well, before we get on into further in the news, we want to wish Dave Bushko congratulations on his move. And I hope this is a promotion for him. He's now the West Coast, what is he? Corporate Communications Manager for BMW on the West Coast. And all of us here have known Dave for quite a while now. So I guess he's going back home because he came from the West Coast. So. But a couple of... Go ahead.
No, I saw that. I saw that notice.
A couple of what I call real hot topics would be there's a lot of press now about electric cars, and Greg and I were in the green room and he had mentioned something that was going on. Why don't we talk a little bit about that, Greg, and then we'll talk a little bit about some other things that I read about electric cars.
Well, first of all, Tesla announced today that they're rolling out some new advanced software for safety in their vehicles to extend the range of their vehicles, because the typical Tesla right now has a battery range of 208 miles, which is double the range of most traditional electrics like the Nissan Leaf or the Kia Soul electric. That was first. Second of all, they announced an autopilot software that is going to be rolled out probably within the next 2 months and also be retrofitted to vehicles sold since October of last year. That will, in essence, let you summon your car, tell it to park itself. It won't tell it to wash itself, though. And basically move along the road to autonomous driving vehicles within the existing infrastructure. Tesla software that they announced today will also let Tesla drivers know, hey, you're running low on charge, and here's how far you are to the nearest Tesla supercharging station. Unlike the traditional 220 outlets, these are superchargers, 440 volts. Plug in, you get fully charged in 20 minutes, and off you go. So Tesla's making a move to really expand their footprint. Currently, they have a charging network in the Northeast along the I-95 corridor. There are plans to expand it, and their vehicles are compatible with the traditional 110 outlets, which will take all day and all night, or the 220 outlets, which we're seeing pop up all over the place. And earlier today, I get an email from ChargePoint. You know them, the folks who actually have the charging stations. They're talking about here in Georgia, there'll be a rebate available for employers who start off from charge point or electric charging stations on site for workers, citing it as a way to incentivize employment where the company, knowing that if you have an electric car with free charging, that's the equivalent of a 5% raise for the typical employee. So electricity is literally in the air today.
Well, we've always talked about it's going to take the infrastructure to be in place before any of these hybrids to really take off, or all electric or the fuel cell cars. And Tesla also won a battle in New Jersey where they can now sell cars directly to consumers in New Jersey, which is really going to turn up the fire, put some heat on the manufacturers who've been successful in other states in blocking Tesla from selling directly to the consumer. And I think the law, the way they changed the law and have it written, is it's only electric cars that can be sold directly to consumers, which opened the door not necessarily for that, for New Jersey, but Richard Branson, the Virgin Airlines, they were in, his racing team was in Miami this week in the first international Formula E race, which is for all electric cars only, and the car that he entered can go from 0 to 60 in 3 seconds. It has right now top speed of 160 miles per hour, and he did announce that he has a team working on an all-electric car, so he looks like he may get out there and challenge Tesla. As you know, both Virgin and Tesla are also in the space race, so it's just natural that as competitive as Branson is, that he's going to jump into the electric car segment. What do you all think about that?
Well, I find it fascinating because Branson, as you say, he's not letting any grass grow under him. The other thing is, you know, you also got to factor in Apple is talking about getting into electric vehicles. If I'm General Motors, if I'm Fiat Chrysler, if I'm Ford, I'm watching these guys very closely. because they may be able to just tap enough of that vein, especially in urban areas, to make a small scratch in the urban driver who just needs a car to get around town, point A to point B type thing. And it's going to make things interesting because the more players out there, as we all know, whatever business it is, the more competition out there, the better the prices are going to be, the more choices the consumer has. And I know that sounds very much like the GOP mantra for a free market economy, but it will also literally force automakers and auto dealers, as we currently know them, to really rethink their business model. Just for the record, there is a Tesla dealership, a true store, here in the Atlanta area, and it's always one of these places you drive by and folks are stopping and craning their neck and wanting to go in and see the vehicle. But as we see more electric vehicles come online, it'll be more actually putting feet inside the store, butts inside the seats, to test these vehicles, for especially for urban driving.
Well, you know, there's also a store in, San Jose, on Santana Row, and it's doing the same thing. It has the look and feel of an Apple store, very clean, very modern. And so you're getting a lot of people in there. Of course, so, you know, most of the people there can't afford a Tesla. However, in that area, they can because, you know, that's Silicon Valley where you have bunches and bunches and bunches of people walking around with a lot of money to spend. The other thing is that I was reading that one of the things that Tesla in particular is doing is they're spurring the traditional luxury brands, not Cadillac and Jaguar, but Mercedes-Benz, BMW, to develop plug-in hybrids. That's the driving force behind those brands developing plug-in hybrids, to respond to Tesla, because basically Tesla, whether they like it or not, and I'm sure right now they don't like it, is a competitor because, you know, they're after the same customer in terms of demographics.
We had a Tesla store in Winston-Salem, but unfortunately due to the clout of the Dealers Association in North Carolina, of which I don't know this for a fact, but I strongly speculate that since we have two mega dealers that are based in North Carolina, being Rick Hendricks and Bruton Smith, you know, they lobbied for the fact that you can't have a dealership that is directly from the manufacturer to the customer. So that dealership has now gone by the wayside. But for a while, we actually did have a Tesla dealer in Winston-Salem, which I was quite surprised. And speaking of that race you were talking about, would we bill this as whisper jets?
Well, they did mention in the article that the fact that they were so silent, it's not like traditional Formula One racing.
Maybe they can get iTunes in the cars and make sound effects.
They're going to have to do something. But, you know, Tesla has, I guess, what they would call salons in a lot of different cities, and most of them are in malls where you can go in and look at the car. You can look at the colors, the interior, and all the options, and they have either one or two cars, depending upon how large the salon is, to get people familiar with the car, even though they can't sell them, but in, I think, maybe two or three states now where they can actually be sold to the consumer. But they use those salons like, you know, you walk in and you take a look at what we have. I think when Tesla comes out with a new model that's supposed to be somewhere around $30,000, $40,000, you're going to see a lot of cars, Teslas, on the road. Because even at 260-mile total driving range, that's way beyond what most people drive every day. It's just It's just the price. It's the upfront price now that's holding them back.
Yeah, like I said, I'm here in Austin, and when I go to, it's obviously a big Tesla market. We're very green here in Austin, and I'll go park at the airport, you know, when I travel, and I'll be amazed at how many Teslas are plugged in at the airport parking. You know, I guess so many owners. I'm just amazed at how many owners there are here. I was trying to look for the information. I know South by Southwest is doing something. There was an event here at the Interactive. They had a session for the electric vehicle. I was trying to look up the information. I couldn't find it, but I know that Chevrolet also, when they launched the Volt, was really proactive and smart and had that Volt sitting outside the Interactive during South by Southwest, giving people free rides and letting folks get in the vault to experience it. So, it's still a tiny bit of the market, as we know, but there's still momentum behind it.
Yeah, one of the things that I saw out of South by Southwest was the airplane that is it's a car that flies. So there's supposed to be some company, and I think they had one down there on exhibit. I'm not certain about it, but I know I saw a picture of it, where it's a car that literally can fly and land and be driven off as an automobile. So that'll be interesting to see what happens. I think the major manufacturers are going to have to rethink hybrids. They may just have to skip hybrid and go to all electric, because if Branson gets in and Tesla's already in there, in the marketplace, they will produce cars, you know, that will be obviously top quality, have the latest and greatest technology, and all they have to do now is get the price down.
Has anyone on this panel driven a Tesla?
Not yet.
No.
I've walked by one. And, you know, what is interesting is when people talk to me about, okay, great, you review cars, what's a Tesla like? And I have to tell them, you know, unless you're among these select few who get a chance to test one, we really have no idea. I tell them, just imagine a golf cart on steroids with a very nice interior. And that sort of gives them a frame of reference. But it's an aspirational buy right now. I want one, because it looks so good. I think, as you say, if they get that $30,000 model out there, it goes from being an aspirational buy to something you can actually acquire. And for someone, like I say, who lives in an urban setting, has a short commute, it makes absolute sense. I have a commute of 2.3 miles from here to downtown. Where there's a charging station. And electric cars make absolute sense. I have family members who have very short commutes, and, you know, they are gradually switching over to hybrids and would love to embrace electric for urban driving. So the educational process is continuing. All of us, think back to when the first Toyota Hybrid came out and how nervous we were about driving it more than 10 miles. Remember that first Prius? Yeah. Well, butt ugly anyway, but... You just remember, we were all very nervous when we went on the ride and drive, saying, will we be able to get from point A, will we be able to get back? Not realizing that it was the first step in that educational process.
I agree with that, you know, in the sense that it is an educational process, and I think the more noise, for want of a better word, that Tesla makes in the marketplace, the more response we start talking about in terms of plug-in hybrids, and the more pure electric vehicles that we get on the market. Basically, what it does is it generates, if you will, an educational center point for people to concentrate on and learn more. Because I was on the lead for the Soul EV. And we went out, we were driving, I think, Interstate 5, I think, headed to San Diego, and we went down, turned around, came back by Camp Pendleton, came back, and there was this huge traffic jam that me and my driving partner basically missed, but the people who were driving behind us, meaning, you know, 20, 30, 40 minutes behind us, they got caught in it. And I found myself thinking, gee, I'm glad we didn't get caught. In this traffic jam, with this electric vehicle car. And the bottom line of it is, it wouldn't have made any difference, because the battery is not timed in terms of you've got 20 minutes of power left. It's time you've got a range. So if the traffic isn't moving, then you don't have to worry about the range, because you haven't gone anywhere. But you know, yet I was still worried about it. That's, you know, it took, you know, a few hours for me to realize, oh, it wouldn't have made any difference. And that's the part, you know, that basically education in terms of more of these vehicles being out, you know, you can get some idea of what they'll do, what they won't do, because if you get a vehicle that has a real 200 miles, you know, range, you know, and that's, give me 200 mile range in February in Chicago. Okay. Well, I mean, that's what I mean by a real 200-mile range, not like miles per gallon on the EPA test or whatever. That, you know, that's the only hang-up, I think, in terms of electric vehicles, is that range, you know. And that's why I think fuel cells may have a chance.
Well, I think you remember.
Go ahead.
On long-range flights with jets, you know, you have the tanker that flies behind and refuels.
Right.
You're going to start seeing electric cars or hybrids with a long cable plugged into a car in front of them in the charger, getting a charge.
Wouldn't that be I told you what I saw here in Atlanta a couple of weeks ago.
Speaking of sight to see.
I told you what I saw here in Atlanta.
Ron.
How about an electric police car?
What'd you say? Go ahead, Greg.
Here in Atlanta, the police department has a Leaf that they use as a police vehicle.
And the criminals laugh at them. They want the chases. They chase me, chase me.
Yeah, it must be designed to catch other Leafs.
Well,
it's a pedestrian killer. Chase pedestrians. Ron, introduce yourself and talk and say where you are.
After all of that little discourse, I don't know whether I want to or not. Hi there, Ron Moorhead from Northern California. Contributor to many, many outlets. I'll leave it at that for right now. And no, I do not ride around in the sleigh around Christmas time.
Okay. Well, we were talking about electric cars and hybrids with Richard Branson now, talking about possibly producing electric cars. And as we already know, Tesla's in the market. Now, Elon Musk really came out with a statement this week that has the industry,
yes, he did.
the industry thinking, and he was saying, in the future, humans driving cars may be outlawed because they would be much safer autonomously. What do you guys think about that?
Well, you don't want me to go there.
I know.
Maybe we should never leave our homes. You know, leave our houses, just become little hermits and hermitosis. I don't know.
But he appears to be serious about that.
Well, you know, it's interesting because, you know, I just noted something today. You know, and we always say, you know, at least I do, that, you know, at least the technology is a lot closer than we think. And I was reading something just today that said that Delphi, of all people, has a driverless car, RDS, and it's designated an SQ3. And they're about to send it from San Francisco to New York.
You know, 3,500 mile
drive. So the technology is there. You know, I don't know whether this law will be passed.
Okay, but, question.
Go ahead.
How would you guys respond if you're driving down the highway and all of a sudden there's a vehicle alongside of you and there's nobody driving it?
I'd let it go by.
Well, I would first be looking for the driver. And then, because we talk about this so much, I would say, oh, that's an autonomous car. But most consumers would be so fearful. They'd be on their phone calling, hey, there's a car that's on the road by itself.
How many wrecks would be caused by people being shock and awe?
Yeah.
They're shocked.
I just flashed back to my misspent youth and some things I did when I shouldn't have. And saying, am I having a flashback to that?
Okay, let's look at the scenario of a little blowing sand on the lines. So the car can't pick up the lines, or maybe a couple inches of water. So what's going to happen? You know, you're sitting there reading your book, and all of a sudden your car's making a left-hand turn because it thinks it's following something it shouldn't be.
Well, I think the technology has gotten a little more sophisticated than that. And they're going to, and if I'm not mistaken, they're going to be using satellite signals and transmissions and GPS and all of that to keep track of these cars.
But and that's been so reliable.
It's not going to be as easy. As a matter of fact, I know it's not as easy. But one thing, Google, with their autonomous cars, they have them in different parts of the country. They have them in different areas. They have them in urban settings. They have them out on the regular highways. and they're logging 1,000 miles a week where they're picking up all kinds of data from different, you know, different driving situations. And the article that I read said the most interesting one they came across was a lady pushing, I think, a lawnmower or something down the street. So they're out there collecting all of this data, obviously, that they can put in their software as to different conditions that the car will have and be able to react to it.
It's interesting. Like I said, potentially it's a case where basically technology is outrunning pragmatism. And when I say that, one of the things, you know, as I was sitting here, I was thinking, well, let's just say all of a sudden you got autonomous cars where you can actually intermix them with regular cars, you know, or cars with drivers. The point of it is, you know, with the autonomous car, who's responsible vis-a-vis the insurance? You know, is the driver's not driving? Is he responsible? It's the manufacturer. Is the manufacturer responsible? Is it the supplier of the autonomous drive system? Because let's face it, you know, we don't know where that's going to come from. Is it going to come from the manufacturer? Is it going to come from a supplier? So there's some just, you know, how should you say, bread and butter questions that have to be answered. You know, and a simple one is from an insurance standpoint, who's responsible?
Right. Well, that goes right along with infrastructure. There are a lot of things that have to be in place before you're going to see them out on the road in real-world situations where it's legal. I mean, real-world meaning legal. Because right now they are driving around in real-world, but they can only drive in certain areas and perform certain tests. But once it becomes legal, then, yeah, all of those things will have to be in place.
Well, I know this is a pretty serious subject, but I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going back to ride my horse.
Hey, Ron, I have a picture of me on a horse on one of our trips, and the caption is "Real horsepower."
Yeah. You were talking about the lady pushing the lawnmower down the street. Well, it is a common occurrence in my neck of the woods that you come up behind, you know, something that looks like a giant John Deere grasshopper that sprays the crops, or a 60-year-old tractor that's just barely crawling along. I mean, that's standard fare around here, things that, you know, you certainly wouldn't encounter in downtown Charlotte or San Diego or Austin. Well, maybe in Austin, Texas. You might find them in Austin, Texas. I don't know.
Maybe on the outskirts, maybe on the outside of town.
Well, I think we've gone horseless for enough time now. Remember, I think last week we were talking about the fact that General Motors has reduced the length and time of their warranties from 10 years to 100,000 and 100,000 miles down to 5 years, 60,000 miles. And I thought there would be an uproar from the dealers because it wouldn't make them competitive with some of the other foreign manufacturers that have the longer warranty length and mileage. But it seems like the dealers find that they don't have a problem with it because, according to them, they'll be able to sell more extended service contracts.
Yeah, well, it's all about the money in the end. I was reading the reason for that, or at least one of the many stated reasons for it, is that, you know, the reason they did it in the first place was to get some traction in terms of sales, and it wasn't providing that. So therefore, you know, like they say, you spend money to make money, but if you're not making money, then don't spend money. So let's cut back on the length. And the time period of these warranties, but that's why they did it. And generally, if it wasn't providing any traction in sales, then the dealers weren't getting any money on the sales side in terms of profit margins. So, you know.
What really helped was Hyundai and Kia when they wanted to distress and use it as a marketing device. You know, when you look at General Motors and Ford and Chrysler, yeah, they have their issues, but I think most individuals that are those customers don't find that a 100,000-mile warranty is going to bring them into the dealership. They're going to buy that brand anyway, I think.
Well, we always have conversations about recalls, and one of the upsides of all the recalls is the dealers have become very, very efficient, and they are providing much better customer service for these recall customers. So as a result, some of the manufacturers, their J.D. Power scores for customer service on a service call has actually gone up and positioned them in a better, you know, in a better light when it comes to winning J.D. Power awards. Jaguar won it for luxury cars this year, and Buick won it for the second time. But there were several other manufacturers whose scores improved because all of these recalls, you have so many more people in the service areas, and they're now tending to spend more time and energy to better service those customers. So months ago, we were talking about what's going to happen when you get all these service customers inundating these dealerships. Well, now we know. They've decided, hey, we have to really treat these customers a whole lot better.
Well, you know, if I could, that is nothing new. When I say that, it's not about what you're saying. It's basically some of us forget, or a lot of people forget, that Saturn made its reputation off recalls. You know,
It wasn't a no-hassle?
It wasn't a no-hassle sale. It was a no-hassle recall is what it was. You know, and I mean, I've talked with people at Saturn. They'll tell you in a minute that basically it was the way Saturn dealers treated customers when they had to bring those cars back in. Because let's face it, I mean, Saturn, at least in those early years, you know, 3, 4, 5 early model years, those were really not very reliable cars. Let's put it like that. And they had constantly had to be brought back in. And basically, it was from the treatment of the dealers when they brought those cars back in that Saturn found itself atop the quality surveys. And that was the reason. And a lot of these dealers, and you're talking about cross deals and so on and so forth within the dealer community, I'm sure that has that was noticed, and I think, well, some of them, the more efficient ones, are trying to repeat it.
Well, it looked like it's working.
Did you see where in New Jersey that they have banned Uber cars and that they are actually pulling people over and arresting the drivers and giving citations to the customers? I saw that on Trump Clock News today. It was like, okay, I guess we won't be taking those. I guess the taxi, there must be a taxi lobby or something in New York City, New Jersey, whatever.
And you know there is.
Yeah, and so, you know, they're just up in arms that, you know, these people are not having to face the same kind of regulatory rules that they do. And don't have the costs that are involved. So, but I mean, it would be sort of a hair raising to all of a sudden have your Uber car pulled over and the cop give the driver a citation and take him to jail, and there you are, you know.
Well, I think Uber has gotten so much press that a lot of states and cities, people think that it's legal in their jurisdiction, and most jurisdictions it's not legal to have Uber. So you know before you go out there and go online and reserve one of these cars coming to you, you better check your local state law, because in a lot of places Uber is not legal. I know in South Carolina they took them forever, and it was just maybe last month or last couple of weeks that they were approved.
I'm glad you brought up Uber.
I can understand taxi companies having a problem with that.
I'm glad you brought up Uber, Linda, because we just passed that in Austin. We just approved Uber. But I think what people don't realize is it's not for everyone. And my boyfriend's a truck driver. And so he delivers trucks, and he sometimes has to get cabs from one drop-off to the pickup. And so he thought he would try Uber because he thought that might be a little more affordable. But they don't take debit cards. So you have to have a real credit card to use Uber. So that's going to eliminate a lot of potential users that are not going to be able to access it. So just FYI.
Here in Georgia, the legislature has got a bill, House Bill 255, that would allow rideshare programs here. One of the challenges, at least here in Atlanta, is I challenge you to find a taxi cab unless you're at a hotel at the airport. And in a lot of communities, not only low income, but even well-to-do communities, getting a cab has become a problem. Where Uber has done is they've actually stepped in where the cab industry, you know, abandoned people, and now that they're getting real competition, the cab and the limo industry, they're screaming bloody murder. Well, fix it, guys. L.A. is an example of where they're finally fixing it. You can use an app, ring up your cab, pay for it via your phone, and keep on stepping. This is a challenge to the traditional livery industry to change its business model to get caught, you know, contemporary. You know, should cab drivers have to pay outrageous rates to get their medallions? I don't think that's fair either. But there's got to be some middle ground. And for those of us who have used both services, you know, all we want is a ride to get us safely from point A to point B. And the politics of it, most of us don't really care about. What we do care about is, you know, transportation. Because there have been some cabs I've been in that, never mind, I'll walk next time.
Well, the other thing I've heard about, even, you know, with Uber and other ride-sharing programs, the main one being safety. And the other one was what we were talking about with autonomous cars. If you're in an accident, most of these drivers, I don't know whether they're bonded or not, or do they have to be bonded? And if they are, how much? So, you know, who's going to cover you if you're in an accident? And I'm sure there have been accidents, and there have actually been cases of Uber where passengers were assaulted. So it's a different kind of ride-share program. I don't think that they're going to go away, but there's going to have to be probably, you don't want to hear, but more regulation as to what you have to go through to become an Uber driver or either any ride-share driver.
I saw a report where a woman that lived in, I think it was in Brooklyn, she used Uber to transport her children to school in the morning. Now, I don't have any kids, so I'm probably not legitimate in even having an opinion on this, but I just don't think I would put my child in a vehicle with a car that was a private individual that just showed up with a magnetic stick on their door and say, have a good day at school. I would be nervous as a cat on a hot tin roof.
Yeah, that's one of the things I understand that the cab organizations in New York City have taken Uber and what's the other one? There's one other bigger one. To court, specifically about the safety issue, that they're not being background, they're not being checked and licensed now. Obviously, some of it is gaining money for the city or the county or whatever. However, there is a safety issue there that Uber hasn't really looked at very, very deeply anyway.
Yeah, any of you remember gypsy cabs or jitney cabs?
Yeah.
In a lot of urban centers in the Northeast, Pittsburgh, Baltimore, New York, where you couldn't get a cab to come into certain neighborhoods, these illegal gypsy and jitney cabs sprung up and did a thriving business for not a year, but for generations. So this is not a new business model. It is basically responding to the need that, to an unmet need, and I'm not pleading on behalf of Uber or the rideshare, but the reality of it is people need to get from point A to point B. If you can't get an affordable taxi ride, or the taxi just doesn't show up, then you're going to go to plan B. Linda, I understand your concern and fear, but I have the same fear. If you put your kids in your neighbor's car going to school, what happens if there's an accident and your neighbor's an idiot behind the wheel?
Oh, I agree with you. Now, I have a friend that lives in Midtown Atlanta, and she uses Uber all the time, and she loves it. But personally, if I lived in Midtown Atlanta, which is never going to happen anyway, but if it did happen, I would not want to. Yeah, right. No grass, you know, no place for the dogs. I couldn't see myself using that service because I have the assumption, although it may be erroneous that I have this assumption, that there are background checks and licensing and, you know, at least job interviews with the parent company of the cab company, that you have some confidence that this is a reputable individual driving this taxi cab. Now, I agree with also what you said. I have been in some taxis that I really wouldn't want to go there again. But, you know, it's like when this is somebody that just is taking their second car out of the driveway and doing this sort of on a wing and a prayer, I don't know. I would be skeptical. That's just me.
Well, let's get on it. Let's move on to one of our favorite topics that we have to cover every week, and that's recalls. We have some more. We try to let people know their car may be in jeopardy. Right now we have 64,000 Chevy Volts being recalled because they need a software update. They may idle. And obviously when the car is idling, it's going to give off carbon monoxide. So if you leave it running and it could be sitting in a garage or something like that, guess what? You all know what happens. You can't breathe carbon monoxide on a regular basis. And Honda's recalling 70,000 plus models for the Takata airbag situation. So that particular issue is still going on. And GM stopped the sales of the Track and the Encore. They're recalling something like 2,300 because the electric power steering may be lost. So we still have, and I'm sure that's not all of the recalls, but that's enough for this show. Let's talk about something that a manufacturer is doing is positive, and Valerie mentioned Toyota earlier. Toyota just donated $50,000 to four Alabama black colleges. And I don't know whether you know it or not, but Toyota, I think, is the number one. I know it's for the Hispanic market. It may be the number one between Toyota, I think, and Nissan in the African-American market. But Toyota and Honda are doing a lot in terms of providing scholarship funds. But most recently, Toyota did award $50,000, and that's for African-American students to be awarded scholarships to go into one of these four black colleges.
As I mentioned when we were in the green room, I was recently in Mississippi, and I was amazed at the preponderance of Nissan vehicles that I saw in rural Mississippi. That, you know, lots of Altimas, you know, just, you know, Maximas, just a huge number, an inordinate amount of Nissans in the population. And where I was pretty far from the Nissan manufacturing plant. But I think they've just generated an enormous amount of goodwill in the community by relocating to a state that desperately needs some business.
Right. Right.
And I don't know if you all went to the luncheon at the Chicago Auto Show, but Jose Munoz, you know, the new head guy at Nissan, talked about what they had done, and he already has a track record of community involvement, and that's how Nissan was able to become the number one brand in Mexico, beating out General Motors, and so I think they have 25% share in Mexico. So I think he was talking about how they're going to take that model into the U.S. and they really want to increase their sales. So I think you'll see a lot more community involvement for sure from Nissan, and I'm guessing, Linda, that might be what they've already started to do to improve their image and to, you know, because folks really do care about that. People, you know, might not think so, but I think it does matter for the general consumer about the company that you support. We have a choice with our dollars, and so if you see it's a company that's doing a lot and really contributing to the community, helping out, that makes a big difference.
Well, people are very, very loyal to a company that comes into their area and employs people. It makes a big difference for a lot of smaller areas, you know, particularly when you look at the South that's been so depressed economically for so long.
Yeah. I thought it was a stroke of genius on the part of Toyota to build their truck plant in Texas. I mean, you know, Texas is the birthplace of all pickup trucks, is it not? And so to bring in their truck plant there and to manufacture that and have a lot of people that are working there buy Toyota trucks and, you know, the domino effect, I really thought that was a very savvy move that they picked Texas to put their truck plant.
Absolutely, and in the local advertising for Toyota, you'll see for the Tundra, in Texas anyway, they say Texas made. They always make sure to let everybody know it is made a Texas made truck.
What's the Willie Loman statement? Go where the money is.
Yeah. You know, as panelists, we've been doing this so long now. It's like when you all bring up a topic, it just channels right into my next in the news, and the next in the news piece was. Trucks now are becoming heavily leased. I think they jumped something like 14% of the leasing now is truck buyers leasing these very expensive trucks. As we all know, you can get a truck now that's decked out like your living room with all of the audio and video entertainment that you ever want to have in a vehicle.
It's a luxury car with a pickup bed is what it is.
Well, you know, I saw that same article, and I remember one of the things they were saying is, you know, leasing is a funny business. And the thing about one of the yellow caution flags on this whole business of leasing trucks is, you know, if you're leasing a pickup truck and you're using it to work or doing some work in it, see, there's a whole situation of what happens when you bring it back. And that truck is, dinged, dented, or which pickup trucks tend to do. And since this is a new phenomenon in terms of, you know, this increase in truck leasing, you don't know, or we won't know, what the impact is for another, you know, year, 2 years, 3 years, depending on how long the lease is.
Well, I've always thought
the main thing you worry about is excess wear and tear and mileage.
Well, I've always thought most people leased a vehicle because basically they were shopping a payment. And it's like they fall in love with a vehicle and they say, well, I can't afford the regular payment, the straight up payment, but I can afford the lease payment. And they jump in, and it never ceases to amaze me how many people I run across that do not have a clue about the mileage cap. You know, it's like they go back when their lease is up and it goes, well, I didn't know that. You know, female realtors are notorious for that, for running way over there. They lease their vehicles and they turn it back in, but then it works well for the salesman or the dealership because they say, oh, that's okay, lady. You know, we'll roll that into your next lease. You just sign up to us. So basically they have generated a customer for life.
Well, when you lease a car, you sign a lot of documents. It's like buying a house. There are a few documents that you have to sign when you purchase, but when you do lease an automobile, there are some extra documents that you have to sign, and one of them covers mileage. So you have to, you know, you are aware. You may not want to believe it, or you want to block it out of your mind, but you have to sign a document
aware.
That says, yeah, it's only, you can only drive 12,000 miles in a year, and you know historically you drive 25. The other one is the excess wear and tear that you have to bring the car back in a similar shape that it was in when you took it. And those two things are really what held leasing back for a long time.
Well, you know, the other thing, you know, again, citing that same article, what they were finding was you had a lot of small businesses leasing these trucks. And what was happening was, Linda, in terms of chopping the payment, what they were doing was chopping the payment in the short run by leasing the truck. And then when the lease was up, they were buying it outright. So if you have a substantial number of leasors doing that, or lessees doing that, then the wear and tear doesn't matter because you're going to buy the truck. Yeah. So the question becomes, how much of a sliver do those, say, private individuals or even businesses, but mostly probably private individuals, how much of a sliver do they comprise who are going to who lease the truck and then they're going to bring it back and turn it in? And those are the people who really are going to get caught because, as you say, that mileage cap, a lot of people may be aware of it, they kind of forget it, but that mileage cap can really add up, you know, because I think the last time I looked at it, it was 10 cents a mile. Mm-hmm. Or maybe anywhere from 10 to 25 cents a mile.
Yeah.
You know, that can add up really quick.
I've seen people be hit with $5,000-$6,000 payups, you know, when they turn their vehicle in.
I know people who parked their car because they didn't want to drive beyond the mileage cap for that year. So they had two cars, one they parked and another one to drive. I mean,
right,
which makes no sense.
Anytime anybody asks me about a lease, the first thing I ask them is, how much are you going to drive?
Yeah.
That's the first thing you need to be aware of is how much do you drive? You have to have a good estimate, not a ballpark figure. You have to be right around there within a few hundred miles of how much you're going to drive and what is the lease cap. Because roughly the last time I heard it was about 12,000 miles. Sometimes I hear you can negotiate or pay to get it up to 15. But, you know, it's 12 to 15,000 miles. And if you're driving, you're commuting, you know, back and forth to work, and you've got a distance to commute, not Greg's 3 miles.
You know, jealousy.
Why don't you walk to work, Greg?
Well, the other thing is when I sold in these cars, I would personally look at what they were driving to see how they treated the car. And if you found dents and dings and beer cans and soda bottles and everything in the car, you know, I would say, hey, You're not a candidate for leasing because this is going to cost you a lot of money if you bring a lease car back looking like this.
No lollipops on the cloth seats.
But yeah, leasing is a big business. Dealers don't make as much of a, it's not a big enough profit margin. They don't make as much profit on a lease as they do on a traditional financing. But leasing is picking up, like you've all said, based on the payment. That's on the front end, but the back end can kill you.
Pay me now or pay me later.
Yeah.
That's how it works out, isn't it?
Well, I don't know whether you all have heard it now, but Chevy is coming out with a 2016 Camaro next year. That'll be the sixth generation Camaro. It's going to be a little bigger, a little more powerful, and it'll look a little different.
Did you say bigger?
Yeah, it's going to be a little bigger.
It's already big.
Well, it's going to be a little bigger.
That's my point.
Okay, well, I mean, it's going to be a little bigger. Teeny tiny little bit bigger.
But, yeah, I mean, if you look at the cars in this segment, the Dodge Challenger is not exactly a shrinking violet.
Nope.
The Camaro's fairly beefy. The Mustang is probably the smallest of the ones still existing in that segment. So, no surprise there. I think the biggest surprise is what took them so long.
But the Challenger's built on the same platform as the Charger. That's why it's as big as a Charger. It just doesn't have as many doors.
True.
Now, I don't know if they're going to build this on the same platform as an Impala or something. I don't think so because it's not rear-wheel drive on the Impala.
And the Challenger's always been big, you know, even way back. But the Camaro grew with this new model. And, I mean, you know, it wasn't by a couple of inches. You know, that is a big car.
Right.
If it gets bigger, you know, and bigger needs to be defined. Are we talking about an inch or two? And they're all, you know, are we talking about
an inch and a half or something like that in length?
Yeah. Well, you know, it's a big car now. And I'm not saying that, you know, in terms of criticism, but I can't imagine that car getting too much bigger and still harkening back to the days of when it was a real, you know, muscle car about the size of a Mustang. It's just turned into something else. Actually, it started, any bigger, and it'll remind me of the Thunderbird. You remember when the Thunderbird went from two seats to four?
Right.
And it basically ruined the character of the car.
Here's where size matters.
Yes, it does.
Well, speaking of size, Scion is trying to come back with a couple of different sizes. One is what they call the IM, which will be a hatchback, and the IA, which will be a compact sedan. So they're trying to breathe some new life into the Scion models. What do you all think is Scion's problem?
I think the natural for an autonomous car.
It was a very small niche that didn't catch on. It was trendy for a short while, but those individuals have moved on, and the new young kids that are coming up looking in the 23-year range are not looking at Scions. They're looking at different automobiles. The Scion doesn't attract people.
I think it was built to compete against the smart car, and the smart car had a very brief popularity, if you would. And so I think, you know, that Scion didn't catch on because the smart car didn't catch on the way that they had expected it to.
Okay, we're running out of time here, so let's get into our first thought car for the day, and it is the, if I can get it on the screen here and let you all watch it as I talk about it, it's the 2015 Lexus RC350 two-door coupe, the F Sport model. It's a 3.5 liter V6 delivering 306 horsepower at 277 pound-feet of torque. That's all mated to an 8-speed automatic transmission with the paddle shifters. The exterior color is an ultra-white. Interior is black. It's 19 miles per gallon in the city, 28 on the highway, 22 combined. And the model that you're looking at now has a MSRP of $53,880. First thoughts, Valerie.
Well, I'm probably going to be overruled on this panel, but I am a fan. I love, I'll take a Lexus any day. This one looks nice, sporty. I think the new redesign with the Brindle grille really helped it a lot, helped Lexus a lot. So I liked that look. So this one looks like it's fun to drive, and you know, if Lexus is getting sportier, I don't see that that is a bad thing.
Ron?
I like the basic design. There are a few elements on this vehicle that I'm not really crazy about, like the taillights, the way they bulge out. I was a little disappointed in the power-weight ratio to the car. It wasn't as, on the F series, it wasn't as... It just didn't invoke that I want to go out and have a good time like a BMW does. Lexus has come a long way. I like part of the design elements. I like some of what they've done, but not everything.
Linda?
I think this is another attempt by Lexus to sort of modify their image from being just purely a luxury car into a more driver-oriented car. The styling is one that, you know, I think you're either going to love it or you're going to sort of scratch your head a little bit about it. I personally like the new grille, but I've had people tell me that they're not very fond of it. They think it looks like the front end of a train or something. Sometimes it's a little busy to some people, the design is. But that said, you can never fault the quality, the fit, and the finish, or the reliability of a Lexus. And it's a classic case. If you get what you pay for, you know, $53,000 is not pocket change to most buyers. And but if you're in that price range, you really don't care much about the fuel economy. But you would welcome 28 miles to a gallon on the highway.
Greg?
I like what I see. This is a car that Lexus is actually trying to reach out to a younger demographic with. And the response that I'm hearing from the general public is, wow, that's a Lexus? Yeah, it is. Am I as wild about the monochromatic interior? Possibly, possibly not. I agree with Linda. Fit and finish is going to be spot on. Reliability will be spot on. The design, you know, might be polarizing to some, but this is a brand that needs to do something to get younger buyers interested in coming into their stores now, so that when they're ready to graduate up to a bigger vehicle, Lexus is already, you know, in their wheelhouse and something they're thinking about or have already experienced. So I wish them luck with it. They're playing in a territory where you get BMW and some other serious players who are already established. So, you know, it's going to be interesting. So stay out of the way because it's going to get nasty.
All right.
Well, first of all, I can only see it on in the film strip. So I'm not seeing that much of it. You said it was the RC350 or the RC350 F Sport?
It's the F Sport, the two-door coupe,
the
RC350.
Okay. Because, you know, that's the middle of this of the trim line, because there's the RC and then there's the RC350. If it's the F Sport, I thought it was a, you know, because I went on the program for it, so I thought it was a nice car. You know, it was different for Lexus. I think it, you know, it has a funny shape because basically it has a curved roof, which on the one hand looks kind of strange from the outside looking in, but on the other hand, it gives it a lot of space on the inside. You know, when you get into this car, you don't feel like you're in a little cocoon. The interior is kind of like love it or hate it, in the sense of it's got shelves. You know, it's got a shelf where the navigation screen is. It's very, very comfortable. But the point of it is that they're trying, because see, Lexus is getting ate up by their competition, and their competition is BMW, Mercedes-Benz, and Audi. And all of them excel with these small, powerful cars. This particular engine on this car is, you know, kind of off the shelf, whereas on the RC, FD, I think it's the RCF, or just the plain RC, that's the one with the 450-60 horsepower engine. And what they, you know, it's a step in the right direction, because, see, they need engines, they need styling. This car is aggressively styled, and like most cars that are aggressively styled, you love it or you hate it. You can't style a car like this for everybody to love. It's a nice car. I think it's a stylish car. It grabs attention, which is what you want, because you know, basically when you look at Lexus, well, you look at Toyota too, but when you look at Lexus, you never really saw a Lexus that, you know, you turned your head around and said, wow. People kind of, you know, it's the brand reputation preceded it, and people would say, gee, that's a Lexus, because they knew it was a Lexus. But it never generated any excitement. I think this car, for as many people who won't like it, you know, in terms of the way it looks, in terms of the spindle grille and all of that, there are that many, and possibly more, at least Lexus hopes more, that do like it. I think it's a step in the right direction.
Well, I'm one of those that would say, wow, I like the design. I mean, I always like cars that can come out with a radical, nice-looking, different design. You know, it's not like everything you see on the street. And I especially like the rear end. Look like they spend a lot of time and energy on the rear end, because if you look at it from the rear, it looks like it's moving even though it's standing still. Now, we all agree on the interior. It's Lexus. It's quality. The RC350, it turned some heads when I was driving it. The interior, everything looked like it's protruding and coming out at you. Like the dashboard there, it's protruding like it's coming at you. And in my review, I tell people it looked like that's a shelf where you can put things on, but it's extremely slippery, so don't put anything up there. But overall, I really enjoyed this car, and Lexus has won me over anytime I can get in an F Sport model. I mean, I haven't been in an F Sport that I didn't like.
One thing that I did notice is their touchpad for their infotainment system is not very useful.
Well, it's not in the best location either.
Yeah,
because you can easily tap it.
Yep.
And something on the dash will change. But anyway, folks, this is another hour. We ran over a couple of minutes, but who cares? We enjoyed having you. Hope you enjoyed the show. I want to thank everybody again for taking the time out of their busy schedule to sit in with us. We had a lot of conversations about electric cars, the all-electric cars, and those that are being called with an app, the Ubers of the world. And I think that this particular show was a little different than what we've done in the past. We spent a whole lot of time basically talking about two or three topics that seem to be getting a lot of press out there in the marketplace. And I want to thank the panelists for all of their insight. Some of these cars we have driven, some we haven't. But being in our part of the business or our line of work, we can pretty much talk about anything, because that's what we do. If we don't know, we make it up, right, Ron?
That's right.
Just kidding. We would never.
No, you're not.
What you laughing for, Frank? Did you do that today?
I sure did.
As always, folks, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. See you next time.
Take care.
Bye, everybody.
Bye, guys.